So good morning and welcome to my presentation about end-to-end testing. I am here today to convince you that it can be fun to write end-to-end tests, even with a little smile on your face, just like my two colleagues here on the picture. I'm a bit nervous that this is my first time speaking in front of such a huge audience, so please be kind to me. Let's start. So I work at Shopping24, which is an e-commerce company based in Hamburg, Germany, and which belongs to the Otto Group. We have several shopping platforms on which you can search for interior, clothes, multimedia, and other things. And we are basically a search engine for products, so you can somehow see us in an affiliate channel if you want to. My name is Katja, and I'm head of SEO and quality assurance. And in my free time, I like to do sketch notes of events, and I present them on my blog, katjasays.com. Sorry. So I'm a big fan of reliable software, and I get sad when commits go live without being tested sufficiently, if they are tested at all. So this is my sad face. Before I dive in, I want to make sure that we are all on the same page on what I mean with end-to-end tests. So I completely focus on the user and their experience. So imagine you want to buy a smartwatch online. You go to your favorite online shop, you search for a smartwatch, you choose the one you are looking for, put it in the cart, you buy it, and you're done. So this is your customer journey. And end-to-end tests make clear that everything of this works flawlessly. Please keep in mind that the tools that I mentioned during this talk are just those that we at Shopping24 enjoy using and that you might enjoy other ones. But that's not the point of this talk. We found a testing process that we are comfortable with, and that's what I want to tell you about today. But first of all, let me tell you more about the product that we built the test process for. At Shopping24, we needed to automate our campaign management. Because we were unhappy with existing solutions, we built one that fits all of our needs. So it is compatible with multiple platforms like Google AdWords and Bing Ads. Its main task is to handle a great number of processes automatically, and all the changes are synchronized immediately to the platforms. For successful AdWords campaigns, it is essential to optimize the keywords so that you can use the budget efficiently. And with the software, you have easy to understand data insights, which make it very easy to optimize the performance, especially if you have millions of keywords like we do. So here's the functionality of the software in a nutshell. You have a user who has a keyword list that he wants to process. He uploads it into the software, and in this so-called magic box, the ad texts get generated, the keyword booking jobs get started, and the account gets structured. Afterwards, the user can optimize the ads if he wants to. To give you an idea of what the software looks like, I brought you a small screenshot. The content isn't really important, I just wanted to give you an impression of what I'm talking about today. If you want to know more about the software, just write me and I send you more information. So this is today's agenda. First of all, I want to tell you why we needed a radical change. Then I want to talk about our first attempts and what we had to optimize about them. And I want to summarize our experiences and learnings for you. So why has end-to-end testing become so important to us? More and more companies are using our software, which is great. But different companies require different solutions. So the software was custom tailored for ourselves, and we had to standardize it. Also, we wanted the UI to be easy to understand and easy to use. Therefore, we wanted to move to a modern, state-of-the-art UI. We wanted to separate the data templating from the templating, and we wanted to kickstart front-end testing. For that, we choose Vue.js, which is a progressive framework for building user interfaces, and it is pre-configured with front-end testing. So you don't have to configure anything, you can just start writing tests. In addition, I, as the new full-time QA manager, I help to improve the mindset towards testing. Originally, our product was a Java-only application. It took care of everything. It did not only read and write the data from different sources, but it also generated all of the HTML. To create an environment in which we have a lot more flexibility, we separated data processing from templating. So now the Java backend is still there, but it only takes care of the data, not the UI. The UI is fully in the hand of Vue.js, which runs in the user's browser. So client and backend are decoupled and exchangeable. The product team consists of a product owner, two full-stack developers, and three people who create the mockups and who support the developers with business-related topics. As we added Vue.js, we wanted to support the developers by adding dedicated front-end developers to the team, and also me as a QA manager joined the team to help set up the QA process. So during the kickoff phase, the team was a little bit bigger. To ensure that the two developers of the team were comfortable with the new stack, we had a lot of discussions about it, and also we transferred as much knowledge as possible. So after talking with the developers, I got a feeling of the mindset towards front-end testing. And what can I say? Things were bad. I was able to determine this top three of most mentioned concerns towards testing. We are talking about Java developers, but the testing suite that Vue.js brought along was all JavaScript, not Java. So the first concern was to be able to learn a new dedicated language. Concern number two was not having the time to write front-end tests. Yes, of course, writing anything costs time, but that doesn't necessarily have to be a problem. And because our developers didn't have much experience in writing front-end tests, they weren't sure about how these should look like, for example, how specific they should be. With my presentation, I want to show you that it might be easier than expected to start with front-end testing if you find the right approach for your team. So just by show of hands, who of you is a developer? And who of you writes front-end tests at all? And who of you enjoys writing front-end tests? The rest of you probably feels like him. You think that the code base could benefit from some testing coverage, but as it would be you having to write the tests, you prefer not to do so. So I have another question for you. Who of you has had a live bug that cost a lot of money or a lot of frustration? And who of you thinks that front-end tests would have not helped to prevent this? So you are the ones I have to convince today. Just think about the damage bugs have in different environments. Ideally, your tests prevent bugs from happening at all, but such a perfect world just doesn't exist. Having a bug in development doesn't have such a big impact. It is very frustrating for the developers, as they have to spend more time to finish the feature, but except for the development expenses, there are no additional costs. But if a bug does get in your production environment, the impact can be massive. It is not only frustrating for the developers, but also for the users of your software, and also for the stakeholders. So you, as a developer, not getting things done is still less frustrating than deploying broken code. So what is a good strategy to help the product team to embrace front-end testing? The worst thing you can do is to force them to write the tests. If you want to create a testing process that holds up to the test of time, you have to make it feel natural. And when does a process feel natural? First of all, you have to make sure that everyone is on the same page and understands the importance of front-end testing and also sees the return on investment. Tests have to be a part of the product, and branches without tests are not finished and will not be merged. Our vision in a perfect world was testing is easy if we do it right. The mindset should be tests both save time and save frustration. The team is always sure and knows that everything works, and the process feels nice and natural. Well, I know this sounds very ambitious, and even we were skeptical about our own vision, but we thought, just try it and learn from what will happen. So that's exactly what we did. To determine our first steps towards a new updated process, we took a very close look at where we were. As our definition of done was lacking front-end tests, we just updated it. So this means the whole team understands that the feature is not done if it contains no front-end testing. These tests should also be part of your continuous delivery pipeline and run automatically just to be sure that nothing breaks. We use Jenkins for that, but you can use any other tool. We chose Nightwatch.js as our front-end testing framework because we have already worked with it before and because this is the framework that comes along with Vue.js. Our developers often tend to focus more on the tasks to get things done without thinking about the big picture. But each task has a purpose which impacts the experience of the user. So we have to look through the eyes of the user as much as possible. How else can we create user-friendly software? I understand that this is not always easy, so that's why we wanted to try user stories, because we think that this will make it a lot easier for everyone to not forget about the purpose of the things that we build. User stories are short, simple descriptions of a feature told from the perspective of the person who desires this new capability. They typically follow a simple template. As a type of user, I want some goal, so that some reason. User stories strongly shift the focus from writing about features to discussing them. And actually, these discussions are more important than whatever text is written. This is how our first user story looked like. As a user, I want to see job statuses in the dashboard so that I can see when my jobs are finished. In addition, we added acceptance criteria to make clear when the story is done and what should be tested. Add all job statuses to the dashboard. Because this acceptance criteria is not very specific, it isn't clear for the developer when it is sufficiently tested. So what happens is this. I can assure you, your eyes are fine. I just blurred out the text a little bit because it's not really important what's inside of this code. To be safe, the developers thought of every single edge case they could think of, which caused very long test scenarios like this one here. This leads to several problems. The test is too long, and it contains lots of duplicate code. There's too much noise, and it is very hard to read, especially for non-technical team members. Long tests like this are very hard to maintain, and you waste a lot of time on unnecessary details. Here we see the output of the Nightwatch test runner. And as you can see, if you leave out the exact elements, which I blurred out here, you have a lot of noise. Lots of things that are not interesting for the team at all. This feels more like debug output instead of test output. What we want to see is the result of the tests. Instead, we see what the runner does. Nobody cares for this information. It might be helpful for the developers during the creation of the tests, but afterwards, it doesn't serve any value at all. we totally lost the connection to our actual feature. So although we thought Nightwatch was the right tool for us and we were used to using it, the team had some problem with the length of the tests and the runner's output, especially now when there were also non-technical team members. So to tackle these problems, I was asked for help. And I thought that what we needed was a behavior-driven development framework. BDD is basically just test-driven development inspired by domain-driven design. So before implementing code, you write user stories with test scenarios. Also, you concentrate on the behavior of the users instead of just testing random things. I introduced the team to Cucumber, which felt good for them. The idea is that you start with feature files. These are written in Gherkin and contain the user stories and scenarios. The Gherkin syntax enabled them to write plain English sentences, which follow some easy rules, which I will show you in a minute. Note that the feature files do not contain the implementation of the test. As one of the biggest problems was the absence of a good structure, we shifted from testing big pages to testing smaller scenarios. With help of this little abstraction, we got rid of all the noise, which made it a lot more pleasant to read. And also, this made it very fast to write the tests, because you just had to implement the small steps instead of huge blocks of codes with lots of callbacks. As you surely can remember, the majority of the developers are Java developers. So by adding Cucumber to the Nightwatch setup, which supports lots of different programming languages like JavaScript, Groovy, Ruby, or Java, we made it a lot more comfortable for them. And with the possibility to also add JBehave on top of that setup, the developers can now implement the steps in whatever language they want. So here we see the same user story from before, but we enhanced it with some scenarios. The first one is, given a new job is started or finished, when the user opens the dashboard, then the user should see the status of this job. These scenarios are pretty straightforward, as each step is defined in it. This helps us to reduce the time that is needed to write the tests, as now the developers don't have to think about what to test. What you see here is the Gherkin syntax. You can recognize it from the given, when, and then. These keywords are typical for BDD. Using the Gherkin syntax in this ticket makes it very easy for the developers, as they can simply copy-paste it into the feature file. So, ta-ta! That's what they did. But as mentioned before, the test implementation is still missing. This is written in separate files, which are called step definitions. This is an example of an implemented test step. At the top, you see it in Java, and on the bottom, it's in JavaScript. If you look at the second line, you see that it starts with a given annotation. That is our link to our given in the feature file. The cool thing here is that now we can reuse this step to prevent duplicate code. You can also see that we pass in a variable. This way, we can write values into our feature files if we want to. So as you can see, both specs are very simple, and they are very similar to each other. And because of this similarity, and also because the developers got more experience in writing front-end tests, for them, it was easier to test the front-end JavaScript code with JavaScript tests. So who would have guessed that Java developers would actually enjoy writing JavaScript? Now our test runner output makes a lot more sense. Again, we see our acceptance criteria from the feature file. Plus, we see them in different colors. And these colors make it super easy to understand how much of the tests are implemented and which of them pass. So blue indicates the tests are not implemented yet, red means tests failed, and green should be clear. So now let's have a look at an example scenario from real life so that you can see the difference between Nightwatch and Nightwatch Cucumber, how the setup is called, even better. A user goes to Amazon.com and searches for a smartwatch. He then clicks on the first not sponsored result, and he adds it to the cart. When he goes to the cart, he wants to see the product in it. So here you can see the code for such a test in Pure Nightwatch. As you can see, the Pure Nightwatch code looks very complex and it has a lot of nesting. If you would show such code to somebody who is new to writing tests in JavaScript, or even writing tests at all, that person could be really frightened by that. The Nightwatch Cucumber code tests the exact same thing, but it is clustered into sections. And those sections are the steps from the feature file, which start with given, when, and then. So I think now we have a little more understanding of how we can reduce the complexity of writing tests for your developers, especially those who are new to testing. And now let's have a look at the runner output for the test. Here you can see the output of the test written in Pure Nightwatch. Let's zoom a little into that. You see that it is very detailed, and it has a lot of HTML elements. This is something that is neither relevant for a user nor the product owner or whoever wants to have a look at the test result. They do not want to know which element has been present, clicked on, or which text should have been contained. They just want to be sure that the functionality itself works. So that means they don't care about the H2 element of the cart being the same as the product title. They just want to know that the product has been visible in the cart. With the Nightwatch Cucumber output, that's exactly what they get to see. You see the steps of the scenario in normal English sentences and the according status. On the right side, you see the different colors according to the different statuses like skipped, failed, or not defined. So here you can see both of the outputs on one page. And I think you can agree that the Nightwatch Cucumber one is much more pleasant to read, especially for a non-technical team member. The purpose of the test and its steps can be seen in one glance of an eye. Whenever I talk about user stories, I often get the same few questions. A popular question is, who writes the user stories? In our case, we like to write them together as a team, which leads to the second question, when do we write them? As we already use Scrum as an agile framework, we could simply use the already existing meetings, the sprint planning and the kickoff. In the sprint planning, we prioritize our backlog, and we choose the tickets for the next sprint. As we discuss these as a team, we transfer them into user stories right away. Sometimes, not all the conditions for each user story are clear before the sprint starts, like when other teams are involved or when dependencies were not clear yet. So during the kickoff, we apply these amendments to the sprint backlog. Question number three, where do we store them? User stories often get confused with tickets, but the main difference is that user stories are part of the software itself. They are stored in feature files, which also means that they are controlled under version control, and they live and die with the actual feature themselves. Question number four, why are user stories useful? We used to have tickets that were just vague, and this led to too much room for interpretation. Developers implemented features and changes the way they thought was correct, but not the way as it was expected by the ticket owner. So you can say it's hashtag ticket ping pong. Now with user stories, we could save a lot of time and frustration on both sides. The requirements, and also very important, the scope of the tickets are made clear and are no longer misinterpreted. Also with user stories, we not only focus on our users, but we also think like them. And we know in advance how they will use our features. In short, everybody is on the same page, and even somebody who's not part of the product team can easily figure out what we are building and why we are building it. Next question. Do new tickets have to be written as user stories? When moving to user stories, it is a common misconception that every ticket has to be written as a user story right away. That is not always possible, and it would also create too much overhead, as the team already speaks about all of the tickets before the sprint starts. So don't create unnecessary work. And last but not least, does it create extra overhead to update the user stories and the cucumber tests when requirements change? Well, it is normal when requirements change, but as user stories do not contain the implementation of the test, they often have to be changed only a little, and at best not at all. And as cucumber tests are structured very well and easy to maintain, thanks to the small steps, changes are often made very quick. To avoid big overhauls of your product, which might lead to a lot of changes at once, it could help to work in smaller increments. So now we can actually measure our coverage. With the help of colors in the runner's output, everybody can see and understand the progress of a feature at any time. We use Cucumber as a to-do list to stay focused on the acceptance criteria. Also, it acts as a kind of proof that everybody sticks to the definition of done. As the tickets are stored as issues in GitHub, they are coupled to the code itself, and nobody needs a special tool for them. So issues, including user stories and test scenarios, software code, and the tests with the feature files, test code, etc., are stored in the same repository. So taking a second look at our vision of a perfect world, we're happy to see that we were able to make our wishes come true. By shifting from random testing to defining acceptance criteria, we made it a lot easier for ourselves. The developers don't need to figure out what to test by themselves because it's predefined in user stories. This saves us a lot of time and a lot of frustration. Now, not only the developers, but the whole team can understand the end-to-end coverage, so we all know that everything in our product is working. Instead of forcing end-to-end tests, we all together defined and set it up and refined it as a team until all of us felt comfortable with this process. So together, we created a process that feels natural. So all in all, we can say that the integration of testing into our workflow turned out to be easier than expected. Now, also non-technical team members can define test scenarios without knowing the code base. Better tests are written in less time if developers can write in their preferred programming language. If you want to set up your own testing process, please consider the following takeaways. As testing should be a part of the product, all the product team members should be involved into the testing process. So this means you have to work together. As transparency is key to a reliable planning for yourself and the whole team, you have to visualize your progress. Working together means a lot of communication. And as product teams nowadays can consist of members of different roles, it is crucial to use the same vocabulary to avoid misunderstandings. If you don't have a definition of done yet, please define one together with your team and make it visible for everyone, for example, by hanging up a poster. And also, don't forget to include some testing. Eliminate as many pain points as possible. Choose the right framework and write tests in your preferred programming language. Keep your testing suite slim. Concentrate on the most important scenarios to keep the runtime as short as possible. So I hope that you find our insights helpful and that I could convince you that it is possible to create a testing process that feels natural for you and in which you and your team can write end-to-end tests with a smile. So the formula to writing end-to-end tests with a smile is the right framework plus clear specs plus short test scenarios equals writing end-to-end tests with a smile. Thank you for your attention.